Hi, everyone. It's David Thompson with Civil War Monitors Behind the Lines. I'm joined today by Ron Maxwell of Gettysburg and Gods and Generals fame. But today we're going to be talking about Ron's latest project, Copperhead. So, Ron, thanks so much for joining us today.
Oh, glad to be with you.
Ron, if you don't mind, could you just offer us perhaps a little bit of an overview of what this movie is going to be about?
Over the last 25 or so years when I was working on Gettysburg and then Gods and Generals, it became more and more conscious to me as I was working on those films that it became, if you will, a cinematic meditation on why good, honorable men choose to go to war. And as I was exploring that, another question surfaced, I think first subconsciously, and then I was able to think about it, which is the other side of the same coin. Why do good, honorable, ethical men choose not to go to war? And so I was predisposed to exploring this subject when I came across Harold Frederick's novel a few years after Gods and Generals was released. Harold Frederick's novel called The Copperhead was published in the 1890s. Harold grew up in the in upstate New York. He was a boy during the Civil War. He wrote a number of novels about rural life in upstate New York, and I think through his eyes, through his collective work, we have an insight into that world the same way we have an insight into Victorian England from the works of fiction of Charles Dickens. So even though Harold Frederick was writing fiction, it has that ring of truth that you get when you read great literature by Charles Dickens or Victor Hugo, these insights into historical time and place. It just really connected with me. And later on, I found out that it connected with other folks. When he first published the novel, it was widely and well received. When World War I came along, of course, it was a watershed moment for a lot of the arts and culture, and it fell into obscurity for many decades until Edmund Wilson, the great literary critic, mentioned it in his landmark book, Patriotic Gore, which, if you don't know it, I highly recommend, which is a literary review of the Civil War fiction that had been written in that previous 100 years. And he singled out The Copperhead as a singular, unique work, unlike any that had been written about the Civil War. And then his review and his mentioning of it in Patriotic Gore created a little revival for Harold Frederick. Then he fell into obscurity again. And hopefully with the release of this movie, people will be able to rediscover this unique and impressive American author.
Now, this is obviously, as you've mentioned, looking at why good and honorable men chose not to go to war, a very different take than depicting the war with Gods and Generals in Gettysburg. Did you find that there was a different set of challenges and, by the same token, a different set of rewards by pursuing this as a film?
Yes, absolutely. What all three films have in common, I would hope, is an attempt to get into the intimacy, close into the lives of the protagonists. And also, I think what I strive to do subconsciously as much as consciously is to exercise some compassion for the entire generation that was caught up in that horrible conflict. Of course, I've been criticized for this because there are some who don't want any compassion shown to the men who wore gray. I have a different point of view. I take them one human being at a time and try to examine their motives and let them speak for themselves. And again, what all three films have in common, Gettysburg, Gods and Generals, and the new one, Copperhead, is that they are examinations and investigations into, I'll repeat it, why good, honorable, ethical men either chose to go to war or chose not to go to war. I, of course, recognize that there are warmongers and exploiters and sadists and all sorts of awful motivations of why people get involved in war. And I also understand there are less than noble reasons why people avoid war. There are shirkers and cowards and out-and-out traitors. Films should be made about those stories. That's not what interests me. What interests me and what has interested me are where would people like my father have been or my mother have been, my neighbors have been, the people that I live my lives with who try to live decent, ethical lives. And I think this is more compelling to us, because then we can't just say, oh, it's them, it's those people. We have to say it's us. And when we see it's us, I think it's a more compelling kind of a motion picture experience.
Now, where did you film this? Obviously, you're trying to depict upstate New York, but I'm just curious, you know, where was this?
Well, it takes place, as you say, David, in upstate New York. Over the decades now, I've looked at almost every single 19th century, potentially 19th century looking site east of the Mississippi. I've looked at locations in Missouri, across the eastern seaboard, and in Canada. And while I was looking for locations for Gods and Generals, which we eventually, as most people know, we filmed in the Shenandoah Valley and in western Maryland. But along the way of finding those locations, I did do a location survey in Canada, in New Brunswick and in Nova Scotia. And I had remembered some of those sites that I'd seen. So when we started to think about how and where we would make Copperhead, I revisited a couple of locations, Shelbrook and Sherbourne in Nova Scotia and King's Landing in New Brunswick. As a matter of fact, I was looking at those locations in December, I think it was, initially of 2010, and it was icy cold and covered with snow, but we still got a good impression. And thereafter, I think over the next year, we committed to making the movie at King's Landing in New Brunswick, and what a wonderful choice and what a wonderful experience that turned out to be.
King's Landing is really remarkable. For anybody who can get there, I recommend it. As somebody who grew up not too far away, it's a very favorite childhood venture for me. So we've got Copperhead coming out. Obviously, Lincoln came out back in December with Steven Spielberg. It got a lot of play. So we still have Civil War era films that are coming out, and people are really, really interested in them. Why are people still drawn to this era in the form of film?
Well, I think first and foremost, because it is our story, and it is a such a compelling, dramatic, vivid, heartbreaking, horrible story in many ways. But at the same time, encouraging, at the same time, inspiring. It is filled with paradoxes. I think I try to understand why I've been drawn to it. I don't really understand because I didn't really know that when I started to work on the novel Killer Angels, it would take 15 years. I didn't know that it would lead to Gods and Generals and then Copperhead, so that now almost my entire adult life has been in this preoccupation of exploring the passions and the trials and tribulations of the generation that was caught up in the Civil War. I think, you know, when we think about why we're so connected, I think it is our story. It's the war that was fought in our own backyards. True, so is the War of 1812, so is the American Revolution, and for those who live in the West, so is the Mexican War. But this one, somehow, the element of fighting ourselves, the element of civil war, that it wasn't fighting an enemy that was over there, a foreign enemy, a foreign army. We weren't resisting an invasion like what happened in 1812. There's something uniquely compelling and vivid and heartbreaking about neighbors and families being divided and fighting amongst themselves. Then you have these incredible individuals, these heroic figures that rise up, whether they were wearing blue or gray, or whether they were civilians, whether they were black, or whether they were white, whether they were women or men. These incredible individuals who are so compelling. So I have no doubt that, you know, long after I'm gone, generations of filmmakers will be making movies about the Civil War.
And do you think that there's something about film that just brings that war so much more to life than just reading about it? I mean, there's no shortage of Civil War books, obviously, and you're basing films off of works, be they nonfiction and sometimes works of fiction. But is there something that film does that a book just can't do, that somebody, you know, reading it in their den, it just doesn't do?
Well, I'm a great lover of literature. I can't read fast enough. My great frustration is that some people I know are speed readers, and they can really absorb it by reading fast. I mean, I can read fast, but then I'm not enjoying it. I remember seeing a movie years ago. I think it was called Reuben, a really lovely movie, and it's about a poet, and one of after one of his lectures, somebody asks, is extolling the virtues of speed reading, and he looks at the person kind of curiously, and he says, with a work of literature, I think one should take a course to learn how to read it as slowly as possible, because literature really needs to be savored. So for me, literature gives it everything. It's a totally absorbing, totally immersing, utterly captivating and satisfying experience to meet a really great author and enter his or her world. Some of my films start with quotes from great literature. For instance, I quote George Eliot at the beginning of Gods and Generals, because she made a reference in her novel Daniel Deronda about the importance of time and place, the particularity of places where we grow up in, and how important that was as a motivating force for those who fought in the Civil War. Well, I think in the hands of master filmmakers, film is obviously really powerful. You have the narrative line, but then you also have the visual that the filmmaker is creating for you. In the novel, these pictures are painted by the novelist, and you imagine pretty much what you want to imagine. The filmmaker makes those decisions for us, so we see what the filmmaker brings us to see. We hear what the filmmaker brings us to hear, which is not just the dialogue, but also the musicscape, the soundscape. So the filmmaker really can paint an entire world. And for that reason, I think it's got the potential of really connecting emotionally in a way which almost precedes written knowledge. So true, a person can see, let's say, Copperhead and have a PhD in American history and appreciate it at one level, certainly. Because that person will be able to recognize many more layers and will know the historical references. But also, I think an 8-year-old can see this in Lithuania with not knowing any American history. And this is the difference now between the ability to read a text and the ability to watch a movie. That 8-year-old in Lithuania or Latvia, disconnected from American history and even from the English language, can see Copperhead and get it. Because they'll connect with the universal values, with the relationships between fathers and sons, mothers and sons, which are at the core of Copperhead. So this is the power of film. It can take a story anywhere, any place, universally, and connect with the viewer.
Now, Copperhead, you've mentioned obviously the reasons why good, ethical men choose not to go to war. If you could. Anything else that you would want to stress to our viewers as a real takeaway message here for them to get really jazzed up about this film coming out on June 28th?
Well, dissent has always been at the core of our liberty. It's protected, codified in the First Amendment, the freedom of speech. Speech is protected not to protect what is popular at any given time. It's protected to protect what is unpopular or what is provocative. The founding generation, they were so wise. They had lived through the revolution. They had lived through the despotism of the tyrant George III and the tyranny of the distant parliament that treated them in an arbitrary fashion. They were also very close, very, very close in time and experience to the wars of religion that had ravaged Europe. And they understood that even in the best of circumstances, as Madison said, you know, if we were all angels, we wouldn't need the Constitution. Man is fallen, whether you seek to see that in religious terms or not. He is capable of very ugly things. And so the Constitution protects us from the excesses, from the encroachments of liberty that mankind all through history is guilty of, which is why it's so important. Abner Beach in Copperhead respects the Constitution. He wants to protect the Constitution. And although he abhors slavery and he loves the Union, he thinks war is not the answer to the problems confronting the Union, the United States of America. And because he expresses this opinion and the war is already engaged, the bloodlust is already up, boys are already dying, his community shuns him. His community doesn't want to hear an anti-war message at the time when they are engaged in the war against the Confederacy. And so the question for us as an audience is, how much do we really respect dissent? Because in a sense, in a very real sense, Abner Beach's point of view has not been vindicated by history. When we look at the Civil War, generally speaking, there are exceptions, of course, but generally speaking, we've accepted it as a necessary war, as a war that was necessary to emancipate the slaves and save the Union. But my job as a filmmaker is not to look back from the point of view of hindsight, but to go where the people lived, in this case in 1862, the spring and fall of 1862, when they did not know what we know today, when they did not know even what would happen the next year or the next month or indeed the next day. And this is what I think makes a film really compelling, when you're back in the time, in the dilemma, the choices that people faced and how they faced it. And Abner Beach, the protagonist in Copperhead, the reason he's called a Copperhead derisively and contemptuously by his neighbors is because a Copperhead is a southern snake, and they do not appreciate his point of view. So this film invites us to try to understand what dissent really means.
Now, a final question for you, Ron. I don't want to take up too much of your day. This project is, I'm sure, has been very near and dear to you. Do you have something else historically minded in the pipeline, or are you going to try and branch out?
Well, I love costume dramas, as they're called, because you get to go in another world, another time, another place, and see the world through the eyes of the people who lived in different times. They're different from us in many ways, but they're the same as us in many ways. We have the universal connection across time and space. We recognize those people. We could be those people. And yet, they wore different clothes. They had different manners. They believed slightly different things. They were in a different moral universe. So I love the journey to go in and to explore that different moral universe. And yes, I'm working on a Western that takes place in the 1880s called Bell Star. It's an extraordinary story based on a novel written by Spear Morgan. And I've also been working for a long time on an epic motion picture on Joan of Arc, which is an original screenplay based on the historical record. And I'm also developing now a story on a story that takes place during the Highland Clearances. And those who know Scottish history know that that happened at the end of the 18th and the beginning of the 19th century, when the Scottish Highlanders were forcibly evicted from their land, what we now call genocide. They were forcibly evicted from their land to make room for sheep, because the price of wool was so high that the Scottish lairds, the landowners, would rather have sheep on their property than human beings. It's a great tragic story. But again, filled with interesting characters, and I'm working on developing a screenplay on that subject right now.
Wow, sounds like no shortage of projects on your end, Ron.
But, I just need to stay healthy and strong.
Absolutely, absolutely. But in the meantime, I think safe to say everybody needs to get to the theater come June 28th and see Copperhead. Looks like just a remarkable story, a very different change of pace from Gods and Generals in Gettysburg, and I think it's a story that people should hear, and certainly in this time when we are a nation at war, it would be interesting to see and to view what it was like, 150 years ago. So, Ron, thanks so much for taking some time out of your day, and hopefully we can have you back on again at some point.
Thank you, David. Good to be with you.